Good afternoon, colleagues. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face masks should be worn while moving around the Chamber and the wider Holyrood campus? The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio is Justice and Veterans. As ever, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary, I would ask them to press the request to speak button to place an R on the chat function during the relevant question. Question number one has not been lodged. Question number two, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the OSCE report, Policy Responses to Technology-Facilitated Trafficking in Human Beings, and accompanying recommendations on action areas for parliaments.
Minister Ashrigan.
The recent OSCE report raises important questions about technology-facilitated human trafficking. And the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act of 2015 provided police and prosecutors with greater powers to detect and prosecute perpetrators, including where offences are committed online. However, we keep the criminal law under continual review to ensure that it is effective. The regulation of internet and online service providers remains a reserved matter, and we are continuing to liaise closely with the UK Government on its forthcoming online safety bill.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Minister for her response. Recognising the horrific scale of the problem that online technology is used to lure, groom and exploit children and adults through exploitative images and threats, and that 2021 was the worst recorded year for online child abuse, does the Minister see any devolved capacity for the Scottish Government to take forward recommendations in policy or legislative change, for example, in empowering law enforcement to efficiently investigate technology-facilitated trafficking or tackling the demand that fosters trafficking of women and children, such as banning pornography?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. We will continue to explore all available options to reduce the prevalence of exploitation, including online. And in Scotland, we will look specifically if there is more that we can do on this. I'd like to offer the member an opportunity to have a meeting to possibly discuss this further. But on the 4th of February 2022, the UK Government announced additional priority offences to be written onto the face of the UK Online Safety Bill. So we understand that that will include offences involving sexual exploitation. So in principle, we think this is a welcome move, and it aims to make the internet hostile to pimps and human traffickers. And once we have more detail on the bill, I think we'll consider this very carefully, especially in terms of the scope of the domestic model that we are developing to challenge men's demand for prostitution.
Thank you. A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Jamie Green.
Thank you. Christian Action have warned that processing a large number of Ukrainian refugee visas may miss some of the red flags that are usually used in vetting. Can I ask what discussions the Cabinet Secretary has had with either the UK Government officials, the NCA, or indeed Police Scotland to ensure that no refugee who comes from Ukraine to Scotland becomes a victim of exploitation via serious organised criminal gangs or otherwise?
Minister.
I think the member is absolutely right to raise this. We know this could be a risk. So there's a number of immediate measures that have been taken to respond to the crisis, including monitoring of online searches. So there's been a spike in searches for Ukrainian women for sex and marriage that's been recorded. Translated information is being provided to fleeing Ukrainian nationals in country. That's informing them of their rights and their options. And the temporary protection mechanism established by the EU also includes a temporary residence permit and access to the employment market. And then on the 13th of March, the Organisation for Security and Cooperation in Europe Special Representative Coordinator for Combating Trafficking, they also visited the Polish reception centres looking to inform policymakers on how best to support those that are displaced and prevent the risks of trafficking. Obviously, once refugees come into Scotland, we then need to look at risks, and we need to look at safeguarding there. It is great that so many Scots have potentially will open up their homes as part of the UK government's sponsorship scheme. I think we do have some concerns about the matching process, and we're certainly going to be looking, and we don't have it at the moment, but we're looking for further information on the approach that's going to be taken in response to safeguarding, and I'll update the Chamber when we have more information on that.
Thank you. Ruth McGuire.
Presiding officer, trafficking gangs are motivated purely by profit. To end their cruel trade, we must disrupt the market. When will the Scottish Government take action in that regard by making it a criminal offence to enable or profit from the prostitution of another person, ending male demand by criminalising paying for sex, so that Scotland is no longer a place where these criminal gangs can operate in plain sight on so-called adult services websites?
Minister.
So Police Scotland will actively investigate all reports of sexual exploitation, and that includes online sexual exploitation. And procuring for the purposes of prostitution is still an offence, for example, if it's committed online. But we know that more needs to be done with the powers that are available to us to disrupt this activity and to shut down the routes to exploit people. And we are committed to the development of a model for Scotland which effectively tackles and challenges men's demand for prostitution. And the multi-agency working group considering the principles to underpin this model held its penultimate meeting yesterday. And an emerging theme from their work, which I know that the member understands very well, is that advertising which happens online can't be seen on this issue in isolation. It's synonymous with human trafficking and intersects with many other forms of gendered violence. And we will take this into account as we design the model in consultation with stakeholders. And we welcome the views of the cross-party working group on commercial sexual exploitation in this process.
Thank you. Question number three, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response to the report on misogyny and criminal justice in Scotland published on International Women's Day, which calls for a misogyny bill in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Along with the First Minister who addressed the Parliament on International Women's Day, I welcomed the recommendations in the report and have thanked Baroness Helena Kennedy and the working group for their efforts over the past year. The work is pivotal in challenging society's tolerance of misogyny and sending a clear message that male attitudes which emanate from prejudice and misogyny have no place in a modern equal Scotland. We will now consider these recommendations and provide our response in due course with the benefit of time to examine them further. It is now incumbent upon the Scottish Government to examine these with a view to ensuring that any provisions recommended to Parliament are workable and can meet the expectations and intention behind the Working Group's report.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I welcome the Government's commitment to closely consider the recommendations in the report. This week, the Mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, has launched a campaign calling for men to take more responsibility for their actions and avoid acting as bystanders when their peers behave inappropriately towards women. Baroness Kennedy's report refers to women having to carry out safety work to protect themselves from the harmful behaviours of men, and the recommendations for new laws would still leave the onus on women to report and evidence male behaviour. Does the Scottish Government have any plans to run a similar campaign, and will it take any further action to reduce the burden of responsibility placed on women in the fight against misogyny?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member is absolutely right that the need for a change in behaviour is on the part of men in relation to this. And if you can take some comfort in her question from the way that we worked with the police to ensure that when they came up with a protocol after the Sarah Everard case, that protocol was designed to take the onus away from women to have to change their behaviour and put it onto the police officers. I think we will concentrate throughout this process, and it will take some time because the member will be aware this is a new departure for legislation in terms that it specifies women, which we have not done before, for example, in the Domestic Abuse Act. But throughout this process and wherever we end up, we will consistently point to the fact that it's men that have to change their behaviour here. As to campaigns, again, we'll look at that as time goes on. We'd want to do that in conjunction with legislation, of course, where that was necessary. But the message will remain the same, and it's one I'm sure which the member would agree with, that the need for change here is on the part of men. And if we get to the stage of having this legislation on the statute book, it will have, of course, a practical effect. It will be an offence, but it will also have a symbolic effect to say these things should not be permitted. And the point the member makes about men as bystanders being the people that should step up and say that is wrong, especially at what might be termed low-level misogyny, which can often lead to other things. I think the law itself can be a symbol for that change, and that's what we intend.
And again, a couple of supplementaries. First, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that misogyny within politics will not negatively affect or delay policymaking in this area?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a very important point that the member raises. There is, of course, a need for caution for any government to prescribe how political debates and discourse is conducted. But we are all in government and not in government public representatives, and we all have an individual duty to watch our behaviour in relation to this and try and make sure that, again, in common with a point made by the previous member, that where things are done, they are called out by people. For our part, the Government is currently considering the working group's recommendations, which have garnered a lot of support, a lot of support in principle from public and from stakeholders and politicians as well. And as I've said, the work is pivotal in challenging society's tolerance of misogyny, in particular men's tolerance of misogyny. And I hope that the Parliament will work with the Government. We are all, as I say, public representatives to meet the expectations and the intention behind the working group's report.
I'm Beatrice Wishart.
Does the Scottish Government consider that, in light of the recommendations from Baroness Kennedy and the Working Group, a cross-party commission on the prevention of violence against women and girls has merit in ensuring that misogyny and violence against women are addressed holistically?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would say to the member, of course, we'd always want to keep an open mind, and the member's made that suggestion before, but there is quite a substantial degree of activity ongoing currently. For example, the minister has an overarching responsibility to take forward issues relating to violence against women and girls within government. We have, of course, a number of pieces of legislation which are going to address this directly, which they themselves have led to the establishment of other working groups. So we will keep that in mind, but I don't think there's any way in which the government could be described as not taking this issue seriously, if it can be bolstered by other innovations such as the one that the member suggests, and I'm happy to consider that further.
Question number four, Paul Keane.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle antisocial behaviour on Scotland's railways.
Minister.
The pandemic presented unprecedented challenges across Scotland's railways, including increased antisocial behaviour. And as we recover, British Transport Police data show that offences of this nature have been reducing since last October. British Transport Police work closely with partners on joint initiatives to deter crime on the railway, for example, Operation Safer Shores and Operation Ballaton both safely manage high volumes of passengers to Balloch and Ayrshire during the holiday periods. The Transport Minister has discussed these concerns in recent meetings with trade unions, and her officials liaise with the Safer Transport Strategic Group, led by the British Transport Police.
Paul Keane.
Can I thank the Minister for her response? I note the Transport Minister's comments to the Transport Committee today that legislation may be required to tackle antisocial behaviour, but it's clear that we have to deal with the problem that is in front of us just now. And indeed, in my West Scotland region, there has been a concerning and consistent trend of extreme violence, particularly between teenage girls on the railway. I think it's clear that staff need better support, and we must ensure that ticket offices are protected and staffing indeed increased to ensure safer railways. I think what is clear as well is that
question, please, Mr.
The Minister would provide assurance that there will be consultation with British Transport Police, the RMT, ASLEV and other trade unions about how we can get the solutions we need right now.
Minister.
So assaults, either verbal or physical, on staff are completely unacceptable. And although it's no consolation to those staff the member has rightly suggested are impacted by behaviour of these types in Scotland, they make up about 3.6% of the total staff assaults on the UK rail network. So physical assaults on staff members have remained consistent throughout the year, with only slight fluctuations month by month. And the offending is sporadic and follows no pattern in terms of location, offenders or timings. However, as I mentioned in my previous answer, there is some multi-agency working going on here in order to address this type of offending, to put resources into the right areas in order to look at that. The member also mentioned work about potential, particular passengers and then presenting, being problematic time after time again, and whether that's something that could be looked at. My understanding is that that option will be explored further as part of the work on safety on public transport. But I would ask my colleague, the Minister for Transport, to perhaps speak to the member directly on this issue.
Again, another couple of brief supplementaries. Firstly, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that I've brought partners together to discuss and try and put some solutions in place to help one of the lines in Inverclyde. And one of the issues that's come up is the issue of the number of officers in the British Transport Police. And with that, what consideration has been given to actually increasing the number of British Transport Police officers on Scotland's railway to actually help prevent antisocial behaviour?
Minister.
Yes, I thank the member for raising this issue and for the work that he's been doing personally to try to address it. So we are aware of concerns about an increase in criminal behaviour on trains, particularly from the rail unions and employees who often experience this type of behaviour themselves directly. And clearly we need to ensure that there are appropriate ways of addressing and preventing such behaviour. But policing on the railways is, however, a reserved matter. And as such, resources are governed by the British Transport Police Association, with ScotRail contributing towards the costs and Scottish interests being fed in through the Scottish Railways Policing Committee. ScotRail has a police service agreement with British Transport Police to secure their services on the railway in Scotland, and Scottish ministers meet with the British Transport Police Association and the British Transport Police regularly to raise issues of interest, such as tackling antisocial behaviour and women's safety with them.
Thank you. And very briefly, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Can the Minister say any more about any potential legislation to deal with antisocial behaviour on the railways? When are we likely to see any proposals, and will it form part of a wider bill?
Equally briefly, Minister.
I thank the Member for raising this. My understanding is that this option is just currently at the very early stages of being explored, and it's part of this wider work that the Minister for Transport is taking forward on safety on public transport. So I will ask the Minister for Transport to speak to the Member, and perhaps she is able to give the Member an updated timetable.
Question number 5, Stephen Kerr.
Police officers are currently serving in Police Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The recruitment of police officers is a matter for the Chief Constable, who considers the size and shape of the policing workforce in light of changing demands. The latest figures show there were 17,117 police officers in Police Scotland as at 31 December 2021. The current Scottish Government statistics show that we currently have around 32 officers per 10,000 population, compared to around 23 per 10,000 population in England and Wales.
Stephen Kerr.
In January, I asked the Cabinet Secretary what the police officer base level in Forth Valley was, and he responded he didn't know. The base level is the minimum level of police that are available to respond to calls in any area. I asked the same question in a Freedom of Information request to Police Scotland, asking about base operational levels, when they were last reviewed, how many times it fell below the safe level. These questions were refused on the grounds of being expensive or being unsafe to publish. If the Cabinet Secretary doesn't know and Police Scotland won't tell, how can we have any assurance that the number of police who are available to respond to calls on the front line in any way is adequate? And what is he doing to make sure that there are enough police to respond to emergency and non-emergency calls?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think one thing we are doing is sticking with the idea that the police are independent of government and they should be the ones to respond to configurations of police officers to respond to the threats that he said, unless he's looking for direct control of government policing, which of course is quite possible the case under the Conservatives. Or it may be, of course, it may well be just that Stephen Kerr is so embarrassed by the one example of Tories in government and policing where they fail to fund police numbers. I know he doesn't want to hear it, where he doesn't want to hear about police pay and the way the Tories treat police pay, or where they want to hear about Tories, the Tory Prime Minister that doesn't think fraud is a real crime, or where the Tory
Prime
Minister
thinks
that fraud...
Can we please, Cabinet Secretary, a second. Can we have a bit more decorum? We've listened to the question in silence, so let's listen to the answer, by and large, in silence, Cabinet Secretary.
Just to say that it may be that the embarrassment caused because the Conservatives have one example where they have control of government and their record on policing is lamentable, whether it's in terms of police numbers, whether it's in terms of police pay, or even in terms of their attitude to crime, where their Prime Minister says that fraud is not really a crime and it shouldn't count as part of the figures. It's embarrassment which has led to this question. He should ask the police and he should allow the police to do their job.
One brief supplementary, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how many schools in Scotland have a campus police officer?
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, that is a matter for the police. The information, as I've said to the previous member, is not held centrally by the Scottish Government, but the use and the funding of campus officers, who I would agree can sometimes make a fantastic difference in schools, is a matter for Police Scotland and, in that case, for the local authority to decide.
And very briefly, Kenneth Gibson.
Officer, can the Cabinet Secretary advise the Chamber what the increase or decrease in police numbers has been in Scotland since 2007 and how that compares with south of the border, where Mr Kerr's party has now been in office for 12 years?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Again, I hear some unwillingness to hear the answer, but the answer is that Scotland has a higher number of officers... than at any time during the previous administration, while in England and Wales,
Officer numbers fell by almost 20,000 in 2017 and remain over 4,000 lower than in 2007. That's the Tories for you.
Thank you. Question number 6 and question number 7 have been withdrawn. Question number 8, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the most recent Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service court backlog figures.
Cabinet Secretary.
I meet regularly with the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to discuss both their monthly and quarterly official stats on criminal case activity in Scotland and how we can continue to tackle the backlog built up as a consequence of the pandemic. The statistics remain that the pandemic has had a significant impact on our justice sector, just as it had on every other sector in Scotland. What is important is that we have a plan and strategy in place, including an extra £53.2 million for a Justice Recovery Fund in 22-23 to move matters forward, recognising that unnecessary delays are not in the best interests of victims, witnesses and the accused.
Rachel Hamilton.
Cabinet Secretary for that answer. But stats released last month showed that there was a backlog of 43,606 trials in Scotland, the highest on record. David Fraser of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service told the Justice Committee that this backlog could take until 2026 to clear. This means victims of crime are waiting years for the opportunity to seek justice. I absolutely understand the pressure that the courts have been under as a result of the pandemic, but the stats show that the government is now spiralling out of control. We've heard from Keith Brown how the government intends to tackle the backlog, but whilst it does, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what specific measures are being put in place to support victims of crime whilst they endure an unprecedented wait for a trial as a result of this government's inability to get a grip of the situation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, given the seriousness of the situation which has just been outlined, you would have thought that the UK Government would recognise that in the grant settlement to the Scottish Government. But no, what we have is a situation where they say COVID is over. We know, and the member's question suggests that she knows, COVID is not over. And of course, we have allocated £53.2 million to doing this. It includes things like 16 additional courts. We are taking the measures, but we know, especially in relation to health and justice, that unlike the Tories, the pandemic and its effects are not over. So we are tackling it, and in relation to victims, I've mentioned before in the Chamber, and happy to provide more information to Rachel Hamilton on the additional funding we provided to victims' organisations to help victims. It's only a shame that the only people that don't seem to recognise how bad the situation is, and of course it's substantially worse than England and Wales, are the Tory government, which she's allied to.
Briefly, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what funding was made available to tackle the court backlog.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've mentioned the £50 million last year, the £53 million this year. That included, as I've said, setting up 16 additional Solomon Summary Courts from September. We've also established a Justice Recovery Fund, as I say, of £53.2 million in the next financial year, and that's to help recover, renew and transform activity across the justice system as we emerge from the pandemic. And just to correct a point that was made previously, of course there are delays which we have been told by the court service could take up to 2026. That does not mean that cases currently being called will wait till that time. It does mean that the pandemic will have an effect which will continue right through to 2025 in some cases and 2026. It's only a shame that was not recognised in the grant settlement from the UK Government.
And very briefly, Katie Clark.
Why does the Cabinet Secretary believe that we have the highest number of prisoners in prison in Scotland and the highest numbers on remand in Western Europe?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think in relation to remand, I think both the member, her party and other parties in the Chamber have acknowledged the extent to which the pandemic has led to substantially increased numbers on remand. However, there is a point which I think lies behind the member's question, that Scotland has had more people on remand in the past, has had more people in prison in the past. And I would refer both to the Justice Vision, which was recently produced, which seeks to address this, and some of the forthcoming legislation, which is going through Parliament, which seeks to address the point that she has rightly made about the numbers of people on remand. The Liberal Democrats have made that point as well, as have others in the Chamber, and we are seeking to address that. And I hope that she will find herself and her party able to support those measures, because we do have to drive down the numbers of people on remand and the numbers of people in prison as well.
Thank you. That concludes Justice Portfolio questions. It's now time to move on to the next portfolio, which is Finance and the Economy. Again, I'd remind members who wish to ask a supplementary, and I know a number of colleagues want to ask a supplementary, If they could press the request to speak button to place an R in the chat function in order to get through the questions and the supplementaries, it would be helpful if the questions and responses were as brief as possible. And I call question number one, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that Scotland's economy has a workforce ready to make the most of opportunities that the transition to net zero and the wider low-carbon economy can offer.
Minister Lorna Slater.
I thank the member for the question. The Scottish Government is undertaking significant action through the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan to equip individuals with the skills and training to meet the needs of a net zero economy. We launched the Green Jobs Workforce Academy in August 2021 to support the retraining and upskilling needed for the transition to net zero. And we have provided nearly £900,000 through our National Transition Training Fund for energy efficiency retrofit skills. We will also be establishing a Green Jobs and Skills Hub that will cascade intelligence into the skills system on the numbers and types of green jobs that will be needed over the next 25 years.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but to hit the government targets on heating homes, they're going to have to install a total of 1 million domestic heat pumps and 50,000 business heat pumps between the years 2025 and 2030. Can I ask how the Scottish Government is ensuring that Scotland has enough trained engineers to hit those targets, and how will the estimated cost of £33 billion be met?
Minister Lorna Slater.
I thank the member for the question. As outlined in my previous answer, there are four significant pathways underway to upskill workers in Scotland to provide the green jobs we need. Our Green Jobs Fund is a five-year, £100 million capital fund, which will support businesses and their supply chains to help them better transition to a low-carbon economy. So far, more than 50 projects have been approved for funding. This amounts to £12.3 million of funding, with 850 full-time jobs to be created and safeguarded from this. It is this sort of scheme that will be working towards providing the workers necessary to do the upgrade to Scotland's homes and buildings.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
The reality is something different. The government have known for years that the NNG offshore wind farm was coming, yet only 8 of the 54 jackets are being built here. And the majority of workers on those jackets aren't even from Scotland. Why was the government not ready? Why on earth did it not train enough workers to build these jackets?
Minister Lorna Slater.
I thank the member for the question, and having worked in the offshore industry myself, I know the challenges of getting the skilled workers and of getting them in the right place at the right time to deliver these advanced manufacturing projects. We will be working towards improving the situation with the National Transition Training Fund. In 1 year already, the National Transition Training Fund has succeeded in helping people by providing support for over 9,000 individuals. These systems that we're putting into place now will ensure the skilled workers for the future.
Question number two from Rona Mackay, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much of and through what application process the COVID Economic Recovery Fund will be allocated to Eastern Partnershire Council.
Minister Tom Arthur, who also joins us remotely.
As part of our £80 million COVID Economic Recovery Fund, Eastern Partnershire Council will receive £1.63 million, which will be transferred as a general revenue grant in the last 2 weeks of March. This fund is intended for interventions towards local economic recovery and targeted support for low-income and vulnerable households. Councils, including Eastern Partnershire, will have full discretion over how to target this support to maximise economic recovery in their areas and consider the needs of local businesses, communities and households.
Rona Mackay.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Last month, it was announced that the Tory Lib Dem coalition at Eastern Partnershire Council was the only council in Scotland who applied late for funding to support older and disabled residents to meet the cost of new fire alarms. Can the Minister confirm that this money will, if guidance will be produced on the use of this fund to ensure that it's used to help with COVID recovery?
Minister Tom Arthur.
Can I thank Rona Mackay for a supplementary, and can I reassure her that funding will be transferred to local authorities as a general revenue grant, and it is for councillors to decide how to use this funding to help with local economic recovery from the pandemic. However, my officials have worked with COSLA to agree a set of guiding principles for the use of this fund, which will ensure that it supports businesses, communities and low-income households. As I said in my original answer, East Dumbartonshire will have full discretion over how to target this support to maximise economic recovery and consider local need. Flexibility of this fund ensures councils can provide support where they know the need is greatest, and this has been welcomed by COSLA.
Supplemented from Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the allocation of COVID recovery funds to East Dumbartonshire Council. However, the Counts Commission reports that councils have experienced 4.2% real-term cuts between 2013-14 and 2020 and 21, when you exclude COVID funding. The long-term funding position for councils remains uncertain. So what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that when COVID funding ends, local governments can meet increasing demand from the service users?
Minister Tom Arthur.
Thank the member for the supplementary question. We have had to set our budget in this financial year in the context of what the SFC have correctly identified as a 5.2% real terms cut to our budget from the UK government. In that context, we have still provided a real terms increase for local government, and we will continue to ensure that local government receives a fair settlement as part of the budget process.
Next two questions are grouped. I call question number three, Jackie Dunbar.
To ask the Scottish Government what the impact will be on the Scottish budget in light of reports that UK government funding consequentials relating to the cost of living may not be provided in addition to provisional allocations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Chancellor announced that we would receive £296 million of consequentials in relation to the cost of living crisis, and following confirmation of the final 21-22 UK supplementary estimate figures, we were informed that this was being funded out of a reduction in the previously expected uplift in health expenditure. So clearly the net effect of that will be to have overall less money than we were expecting following the announcement of measures to support the cost of living.
Jackie Dunbar.
Once again, the UK government has made great fanfare of announcing additional consequential funding for Scotland, then quietly conceding later on that there will not be any additional money after all. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concerns about the considerable difficulty this creates for the Scottish Government in terms of managing a fixed budget? And does she agree that this is an utterly irresponsible way to manage public finances?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member who talks about the impact on the Scottish Government should also talk about the impact on the Scottish Parliament, because as members will be aware, the funding position moved on an almost daily basis in January, with figures not formally confirmed until supplementary estimates were published on the 22nd of February. That is just over 5 weeks from the end of the financial year. And during that period of time, I quite rightly updated the Scottish Parliament Finance Committee on the financial position so that Parliament could have all the facts and figures in order to scrutinise that, only for that position to be out of date due to that ongoing volatility. So it's an issue that should be of concern to the Parliament as much as it is of concern to the Government, and certainly significantly undermines our ability to plan ahead.
Question number six, Don Mason.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has received an additional £290 million from the UK Government to support households facing financial difficulties as a result of the reported cost of living crisis.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'll keep this one brief because, as I said in my previous answer, we have received the net impact, which is less than what we would have received if that £296 million had been additional.
John Mason.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for repeating the answer. I know that she meets and her ministers meet with Westminster ministers and officials on a regular basis, and I just wonder if she can share with us if she thinks that Westminster is taking on board our concerns that when they make an announcement, as my colleague said, they should tell us whether it is new money or not.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I will be meeting again with my counterpart, the Chief Secretary, on Monday, and as always, look forward to those meetings. This is a persistent and pervasive problem, and we have raised it on numerous occasions with Treasury in the past. Treasury officials do their best in terms of providing us with estimates, but there is an inherent volatility in these figures until they're formally confirmed. The difficulty is, of course, when funding is announced by the UK government, there are immediate calls, particularly in this chamber, across opposition parties, for us to spend it immediately. And whilst I recognise the importance of getting money out the door quickly, we also have to make sure that that funding is actually additional, it's new, and that there's more money in the bank to pay out, which is a core part of our prudent management of Scotland's finances.
A brief supplementary, Michelle Thompson.
Thank you. The UK Government's failure to follow through on its promise of additional funding and the mitigations then provided by the Scottish Government highlight a commitment to providing the additional support which people need. But we know this will only go so far. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that this Tory cost of living crisis is hugely concerning and that the position of our political opposition to either tell Scotland to eat its cereal or to ask for increases in spending without stating where there should be cuts is simply not sustainable, and that, in fact, the only rational decision is for Scotland to be a normal, independent country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member is right to point to the fact that other normal, independent governments are able to respond without one arm tied behind their back. If you look at what is driving the cost of living crisis in terms of inflation, energy prices and so on, all of these are reserve powers over which we have minimal control. Where we can go further, we have gone further. For example, doubling the Scottish Child Payment. But we can only ever do that within a fixed budget that under the UK government has been subject to a decade of austerity.
Thank you. Can I encourage members not to be shouting their own answers and questions across the chamber while the Cabinet Secretary is speaking? That's on both sides of the chamber, Ms Graham. And with that, Ms Graham, question number four, Christine Graham.
Accused but not guilty, I plead. To ask the Scottish Government what representation it has made to the UK Government regarding reducing VAT on fuel to help mitigate increases in the cost of living for households in Scotland.
You were pointing when the music stopped, Ms Graham. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are acutely aware of the very serious cost of living pressures that are affecting so many in Scotland and beyond. Mr Matheson, my Cabinet colleague, wrote to the UK Government on the 10th of January asking for a reduction in VAT on household energy bills to provide some form of short-term relief, but to no avail. Since then, the horrific events in Ukraine and Russia's unprovoked aggression have caused fuel prices to rise exponentially and have added to the pressures facing households. Whilst VAT policy control is reserved to the UK government, we will do whatever we can to urge that all policy levers are considered. And as I said, I have another meeting with the Chief Secretary on Monday to press this case.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for answer, so I have a suggestion for the Cabinet Secretary meeting. And without giving the Chamber a headache, which I gave myself, so I'm not disclosing my workings, I've calculated that if we take fuel costs at £1.63 per litre at the pump, a 50-litre tank costs nearly £82. Of that, nearly £29 is fuel duty, with a further £13 or so VAT, which is levied on the raw cost plus the fuel duty, doubling the pump price. £42 in tax that goes straight to the Treasury. So would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the elephant in the room is fuel duty, and that in these extreme times it would not be a bad idea for the Treasury to waive fuel duty for a period, saving our public services, the NHS, the police and so on, in inflationary fuel costs, reducing transport costs, which are inflating fuel prices, and of course are increasing energy bills, both commercial and domestic.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would praise Christine Graham's mental arithmetic in the chamber this afternoon, and would agree that fuel duty is significantly contributing to the cost of fuel. Now, the impact of the cost of living crisis is profound on households, indeed on businesses, and also on public services, as Christine Graham referenced. And I think we need to do all that we can at this moment in time to ease the burden being faced by citizens, businesses and public services alike. And we absolutely need the UK government, who are fully responsible for all aspects of energy policy, regulation and taxation, to do what they can, and certainly need them to do more than they've announced to date.
And brief supplementary, Stuart McMillan.
Thanks very much. Can the Cabinet Secretary indicate what discussion that she and the Scottish Government have had with the UK Government about standardising fuel pump prices so that consumers are not faced with a postcode lottery, as prices do differ across the country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member raises a really relevant issue, and particularly as someone who represents a rural area of Scotland, we see the disproportionate impact in some parts of the country. So, as I've assured Stuart McMillan's colleagues, I will assure him that I will pursue all avenues to ease the burden on households across Scotland, and I will bear this suggestion in mind when I speak to the UK Government next week, because all the levers relating to fuel and energy are reserved. Yes.
Thank you very much. Question number 5 from Polly McNeill, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what financial support it provides to Glasgow businesses that have been impacted by a loss of earnings as a result of street closures due to a variety of recent projects.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's an important question that Polly McNeill has asked. Financial support for businesses experiencing a loss of earning as a result of road closures is very much a matter for the local authority to consider because they provide the licences for such projects. But I imagine in her follow-up question, she'll be more specific and perhaps I can give a more specific answer.
Polly McNeill.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. To be more specific then, roads in Glasgow city centre were closed off earlier this year ahead of filming the new Batgirl movie. But the filming is said to have decimated trade for many businesses who, as you're aware, struggled after lockdown and quite severe restrictions over Christmas. The one owner of a bar and restaurant said they'd lost up to 10,000 worth of business. And another one, a clothing shop, closed for a week due to low footfall because of the road closures. They were offered £30 a day from Warner Brothers. And the City Council offered an incentive to the production company of £150,000. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it is wrong to offer financial incentive to production companies without making adequate compensation conditional on ensuring that businesses are adequately compensated for losses in trade? Surely, Cabinet Secretary, as we try to recover from this pandemic, that would be a very important principle to ensure that those businesses have a chance to recover.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, very conscious of the impact on businesses, particularly the ones that she has referenced in her question, on top of everything else that they are contending with post-COVID and with the cost of living. In terms of my previous answer, I'm very conscious that Glasgow City Council have made comment on this. I would certainly expect both the Council and the production companies to listen carefully to businesses, to engage with them, and to determine what more can be done to support them. And the two mechanisms that I would reference in terms of where support might be forthcoming in order to help all businesses affected would be the COVID Recovery Fund, which has been provided to local authorities, and also the Glasgow City Centre Recovery Fund, which they'll receive as part of the £6 million I announced just a fortnight ago.
Brief supplementary, Annie. Well.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Glasgow's taxi drivers have also been brutally impacted by lost earnings. The industry is on its knees with warnings over a cab blackout in Glasgow. Cabbies are now facing further uncertainty with the proposed introduction of the low emission zones in 2023. Can the Scottish Government reiterate what action it is taking to ensure essential support is available for Glasgow's cab drivers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I fully agree with the member about the impact on taxi drivers throughout the pandemic, knowing that they often feel the brunt of any closures or impacts on hospitality. We have delivered a third grant to taxi drivers over and above the previous two grants. I've always been clear that no amount of grant funding compensates for loss of earnings, but it does provide an element of support, and local authorities have been paying that out. And it would be my sincere hope that all taxi drivers that are eligible have now received that.
I'll take a further supplementary from Rona Mackay, but it needs to be brief, as is the response. Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update as to the steps which the Scottish Government is taking to help drive up footfall in our towns and city centres?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet
Well,
Secretary.
The question that the member asks goes right to the heart of this. In our city centres, we need more people. And we have announced two schemes, the City Centre Recovery Fund, £6 million, and the Economic Recovery Fund of £80 million, which is entirely up to local authorities to spend in order to drive up that footfall and support local businesses.
Thank you. Question number 7, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the number of low-income households that will not be eligible for the £150 payment to help tackle the rising cost of living.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would remind the Chamber, of course, that the £150 payment is not the only way in which we're helping to tackle the rising cost of living, not least just having passed a budget which doubled the Scottish Child Payment. As I said, the budget using the council tax system is the quickest and the simplest way to reach those for whom the payment will make a difference, and 73% of all households in Scotland will receive that. But importantly, every household in receipt of council tax reduction, which is one way of capturing those who are most in need, will also receive the payment.
Callum Mochan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. A new study by Energy Action Scotland has revealed that as many as 211,000 additional people in Scotland, a 43% rise from 2019, are set to fall victim to fuel poverty this year, almost all of them in households from already low incomes. Isn't it correct that the system proposed by the Scottish Government, which distributes payment via council tax banding, will spread support far too thinly and low-income households will proportionately suffer as a result and not receive the targeted support that they need?
Cabinet Secretary.
Is right to identify those figures, and it is hugely concerning that the rise in the energy cap will plunge more people who are already classified as fuel poor into extreme fuel poverty and those who are not in fuel poverty into fuel poverty. In terms of the support that we have provided, we've also provided £10 million for those at greatest risk of self-disconnection or those that are rationing their energy usage more. But I would again remind the member that this sits alongside the low-income pandemic payment, the Scottish Child Payment, the bridging payments, continued funding to mitigate the UK bedroom tax, the winter support fund, increased support in the Scottish Welfare Fund, as well as supporting debt and welfare advice services across the country. All of that is designed to help those who are really struggling right now, and none of these policies should be considered in isolation of the overall package.
Very brief supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. The £150 will be a great help to many households, but would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it would be more helpful to low-income households if the UK Government restored universal credit and cancelled its national insurance increase?
I couldn't agree more. I couldn't agree more that ultimately, not only should we be providing additional financial help to households in the form that we've set out already, but we should ensure it's targeted, and universal credit would be one way of more effectively targeting it. In absence of that, the Scottish Government has stepped up and is providing additional support from our own budget as a result of the UK Government's failure to do so.
Thank you. And finally, question number 8, Alexander Burnett, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of removing rates relief for all businesses after the first quarter 22-23.
Minister Tom Arthur, who joins us remotely.
Many thousands of small businesses will continue to benefit from the UK's most generous small business bonus scheme, something the FSB has called a lifeline, which takes more than 111,000 properties out of rates altogether. We are extending retail, hospitality and leisure relief by offering 50% relief for the first 3 months of 2022-23, capped at £27,500 per ratepayer, following 2 years of 100% rates relief, offering certainty when businesses needed it most. RHL businesses in England started paying rates in July 2021, while their equivalents in Scotland currently don't pay a penny.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Now, the Fraser Islander was very critical that the information held on businesses was not fit for purpose for either giving support or evaluating results. And during COVID, we heard from businesses who have been disadvantaged due to differences between local authorities, as North East businesses facing crippling rates significantly higher than those in the Central Belt. So can the Minister confirm what steps he is taking to ensure future guidelines, the data collection, management and eligibility criteria are consistent across local authorities and assessors?
Minister.
Can I thank Mr Burnett for his supplementary and also take this opportunity to welcome the thorough report that undertaken by Fraser of Islander Institute. Of course, the small business bonus scheme has been a tremendous success, and it has been very much welcomed by businesses the length and breadth of Scotland over the past decade and a half. It's also important to recognise that what the report says is that it is not saying that the small business bonus scheme did not have any effect, but it does identify data limitations. And that is something we are considering and reflecting on closely, and I will be happy to update Mr Burnett in Parliament in due course.
A very brief supplementary and brief response, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's welcome that the Scottish Budget maintains the UK's most generous small business bonus scheme. Can the Minister provide an update as to the number of properties which this is expected to be taken out of rates altogether?
Briefly as possible, Minister.
Over the last 14 years, Scotland's business community has had to weather a global financial crisis, a decade of UK government austerity, Brexit, a global pandemic and spiralling energy costs. During this time, we are proud to have supported over 111,000 small businesses with rates relief of up to 100%, saving them thousands of pounds per year. And the Small Business Bonus Scheme has saved ratepayers over £2.5 billion since 2008.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.